Great.
Hello, Molly.
How are you? A lot has gone under the bridge, but going right back, when Queen first started, when you first started as a singer, how did you imagine your career was going to go?
Well, we had a lot of confidence to start with, but I mean, in terms of all these years, I mean, I was virtually going to give it 5 years, to be honest. I thought after 5 years, you know, it's all going to be over and I've got to sing something else, become a child lady or something. But
right.
But here you have it, after 14 years, it's still going strong and I'm pleased as punch.
Well, I mean, why do you think that it's been able to sort of carry on so far when, you know, you've seen so many different musical changes happen?
Why? I think because we're good.
But apart from that, I mean...
I think also we've actually sort of just done the things that we wanted to do. We haven't sort of pandered to sort of public taste or anything, and I think we try to be aware of what's going on, always one step ahead, and but I think in the end it's the good music that actually speaks for itself, I think, and I think we write good songs and we play them well.
Right, now when it came to sort of like the initial start of Queen, it was sort of The English critics tried to put you into a category and sort of almost described you as glam heavy metal.
Yes, I guess that's just a label. I think when everybody starts off, I mean, you have to have a label. They try and put you in a category because they have to sort of put you in a department and label you. It's like any band that starts off now will say, oh, they sound a little bit like Culture Club or whatever. We sounded a bit like Led Zeppelin, a bit like Yes, because we had harmonies. And I mean, they have to sort of put you in some sort of category, but in the end we had our own sort of stamp, you know. We had the Queen stamp, we had our own trademark.
Right.
And a lot of bands that came after us said, oh, they sound like Queen. I bet they weren't pleased either. It's sort of you have to sort of go through that from the start, really.
Right, now with the initial breakthrough onto the English market and then the European market, and then Queen becoming a commodity, coming out to Australia for that first time, which was billed as like this big group from England, and there was the appearance at Sunbury, which turned into what I felt was a fiasco on the part of the Australian promoters.
Well, I thought we played quite well. I loved the way we
arrived. No, I thought you did very well.
I loved the way we arrived in limousines and...
What I mean is that they couldn't quite understand of why any group should sort of wait till you know, sunset, because it was a lighting show and it all became very impatient. I thought the show was great.
They've learned now, haven't they?
Sorry, yes, they have.
Well, there's no point having a light show playing in daylight, is
right.
it? It's just one of those things.
And then after that, going back to England and pursuing, having still chart success, then the Bohemian Rhapsody time. Now, I was talking to the rest of the boys the other day about Bohemian Rhapsody, because in essence it is, in so many ways, apart from the record itself, which was a long record, which was a very full record, and a record that was unusual to be brought out at that time.
Yeah.
The film clip also is without a doubt the pioneer of filmmaking and video making of today. Was it something that was worked on that it had to be that different?
It was just, especially a phase that we were going through at the time, and I think it's a lot of timing, a lot of luck, actually. And it was a night of the opera time, and we were just writing like crazy. I mean, there was so much hunger there. We just had so much that we wanted to bring out. It was all sort of kept in, and so we had all kinds of songs. And Bohemian Rhapsody happened to be, it was basically like three songs that I wanted to put out, and I just put the three together.
Right.
And then it had a very big risk factor, yes. A sort of, the radios didn't really like it initially because it was too long, and the record company said, you know, you can't market it that way. And after me having virtually put the three songs together, they wanted me to sort of slice it up again. So I said, no way.
Well, I remember you saying that where the company...
Because they said nobody would play it. Yeah, they said nobody would play it, you know, that's too long. And I just said it either goes out in its entirety or not at all. So it was a big risk. It was either going to be a big flop because nobody would play it, or something would happen, and luckily, you know, it became a major hit.
Now, just around that period, I mean, like, with your vocal range, were you, did you ever sort of take vocal lessons at any stage? I mean...
Not at all. No, it's just, it's my voice. I didn't, I think most of the time I actually misuse my voice because I mean I have these nodules on my vocal cords, and a lot of the times they were saying, oh, you must go into training and learn to sort of sing properly, like, you know, operatic singing. You have to sing from the stomach. But it's rock and roll, and I just sort of sang the way I do. And of course, I was misusing my voice. And when we were doing these extensive tours of America and things, I mean, I just used to come up with these nodules. And sometimes, you know, gigs had to be cancelled because I could hardly speak.
Right.
I could hardly, you know, let alone sing. So, but that's what happens, and there's nothing you can do. You have to rest. You can't speak or talk to anybody, and then they go down. But they still come back up again.
Right, well, by 1977, 78...
That said a lot about Bohemian Rhapsody, didn't it?
Yes, exactly. But by 1977, 78, and I remember doing an interview with you in fact, John Reed's office, who was managing you at the time, and the punk explosion had hit, and they were referring to you, the punk groups were referring to you and many other groups as being these megastars, that their time had finished
anti-establishment,
and we were about to take
it
over. Yeah.
It was a tough phase for us, actually. At one point, I actually thought it was going to be it. But I think Queen have this sort of, if there's a challenge, you know, we embark on it, and that's what keeps us going. I'll never forget, we were in the studios doing one of the albums. I think Sheer Heart Attack was the track, so it wasn't on the Sheer Heart Attack album. But the Sex Pistols happened to be in the next studio. And can you imagine, it was just like, you know, the whole thing about punk rock and anti-establishment all
right.
Coming under one roof. And I got Johnny Rotten and Sid Vicious in and to listen to one of our tracks. And I said, I'll sing on one of yours if you sing on one of mine. And you should have seen it. We can't be singing with Freddie Mercury and all that.
Right.
I was wearing ballet pumps at the time and right. Things like that. But it was great. It was just... I called Sid Vicious, and I called him Simon Ferocious or something, and he didn't like it at all. And I said, what are you going to do about it? And he had all these very well, sort of, he was very well marked, you know. So I said, did you really, you know, make sure you scratch yourself in the mirror properly today, and tomorrow you're going to get something else? He hated the fact that I could even speak like that.
Right. Then,
so we went, I think we survived that test.
Well, certainly you did, but then during that period also, over the next 2 years, the Freddie Mercury image had, in fact... Do you want another drink?
Yes, I'd love some vodka tonic. Yeah.
Right, hold on. Vodka tonic.
You're not going to go and get it, are you?
I've done other things in my time. Wouldn't mind another scotch and cake, either.
Yeah,
there
you go. Finish that,
honey. Do you want any?
Yeah,
time. I've got my next year. What? No. Throw myself
right down the tube. Okay, we're recording. And I'm set. Going.
Right, through that 77-78 period, the image of Freddie Mercury had grown quite proportional by that stage, just apart from being lead singer of Queen.
You mean I got fat?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, I didn't mean that at all. No, I mean the fact that you were mixing with what rock circles don't normally mix with, the Royal Ballet and people like that had become friends of yours.
Yes. That's true. Well, I like to mix with people I like. I mean, I don't give a shit about what people say. And
right.
But I know what you're trying to say. It's like I didn't really go to just see rock concerts, you know, and just see Led Zeppelin. I mean, I had, you know, different interests, and ballet happens to be one of them. And it all started out when the Royal Ballet actually asked me to dance with them, actually.
Right.
And I thought they're mad, you know, because I can't really dance. I mean, I just... throw myself around the stage, and to be choreographed is a totally different thing. But I did a sort of charity gala thing with them, and since then we became friends, and I sort of spent a lot of time with the Royal Ballet.
Would it be fair to say that that has had an influence on, especially your filmmaking?
Well, I've always, it's theatrics, and I've always sort of, I always enjoy seeing other people in sort of like musicals or theatre and all that, and I sort of incorporate certain of those styles in my work.
Right.
That's basically it. And, I mean, to say that I'm very well equipped in ballet dancing is totally wrong. I mean, I just sort of, it's mock ballet, you know,
right.
And I know it was sort of like, at that time, to actually sort of introduce a certain kind of balletic look into rock and roll was sort of, it was sort of outrageous. And I thought, how, you know, what's a real funky rock and roll audience going to say to this prancing ballerina coming
right.
on. I thought, fine, I'll sing my rock and roll songs with a tutu on, I don't care.
Right.
But it's basically a form of outrage and shock, really.
Right, now then it came into the 80s, and well, in the late 70s and then into the 80s, where there was a complete turnaround of an image that, quite frankly, I don't think anyone was quite ready for with Queen.
Well, what did they do?
Well, it was the haircut, the crazy little...
Yeah, so, I mean, it's a form of growing up, you know. It's like, you know, you get bored wearing the same clothes and having the same look. So basically, I mean, I was just growing up like anybody else, except I was in the public eye, so every time I did anything, they knew about it. And apart from the fact that I was also in the sort of theatrical world and the music industry, you know, I just sort of had to sort of enhance it a bit more. That's how I love dressing up, anyway.
Right. Well, I mean, it certainly worked.
Why did I change? I mean, it's just one of those things. I know I went from, you know, a balletic look to a sort of heavy leather and all that. And,
but the one thing that it did do was it brought in a completely new audience as far as the songs, number one, the way the songs sounded, and number two, the entire look, the way you presented it on video, brought in a totally new audience that I don't think that anyone was quite expecting to happen. You may have, I don't think the critics were ready for it.
It wasn't a calculated change. It was just something that, you know, that people go through. I mean, we were just going through a phase, and I think it wasn't calculated at all. It's just something that we wanted to do. And I think, in the end, I would say the songs speak for themselves. Because, I mean, no matter how much you dress up or whatever, I don't think that's the be-all and the end-all. In the end, if the songs are right, then somehow an image that you create fits the bill.
Right.
Sometimes it doesn't, but it's the songs in the end. I mean, you could, you know, you come up with a real crappy song. That doesn't mean it's going to sell because you wear wonderful clothes.
Right, Radio Gaga was...
But I mean, it's just something that I don't like looking the same all the time. In fact, this look, if you call it a look, is me being sort of sober in my old age or whatever, and I just like being like this at this moment. It's the longest look I've ever kept. But I mean, the more I say look, the worse it gets, doesn't it? It's just me, really. I've stopped thinking of myself in terms of looks. I mean, I know David Bowie went through so many changes. I mean, you know, it's just...
Although David's kept with his same look now as well.
Yeah. Well, he's getting old too, you know.
Do you mix a lot with other people as far as within the scene itself?
It depends.
When you talk about the Bowies, the Altons...
Yeah, like I'm not one of those people that like to go to sort of press receptions and all these... I like to sort of keep myself to myself more than anything, or go to places that most people don't frequent, to be honest. That's just me being me. But yes, I do have friends in the showbiz world.
Do you listen
hate them
to,
all.
Do you listen to many records?
Yes, not as much as people think. I mean, I don't have a record collection or whatever. Oh. I listen to the radio and sometimes I just stumble upon them. That's the best way. I don't go out of my way to say, oh, I have to. Some I do. I mean, like Aretha Franklin, I love to death, you know, and I still listen to her a lot. Otherwise, no, I'm not a very good record buyer.
Right, Radio Gaga was yet another sort of change, not so much image-wise change, but, well, in fact, it was in a sense, but it was a very bold move, I thought, as far as Queen changing their musical style for that one moment.
So
was it something that was written that you had to work on a project, or...?
No, they're just songs that... Every time we make an album, we just go in there and write some songs, and then we pick the best.
Right.
But, I mean, having said that, I think we're aware of the current trends and changes, and we write accordingly. I mean, Brian still, you know, writes in a heavy mold or whatever, and I think between the four of us, I mean, we write very different songs, which is very good, and I think the more we write, the further apart in songwriting we're getting. So I think we're sort of accumulating more and more sort of kinds of research, and we're sort of spanning different territories that way. Before, we sort of wrote in one mold, and then we had different interests, and then I'm writing very different stuff now to what, say, you know, Queen were doing even, say, 3 years ago.
Right, now, moving on then, you have, I mean, the scene with Michael Jackson being so big, the whole Michael Jackson image, it being analysed, Michael going into a shell. Then you come with, you know, on the English side with the Boy Georges, the Marilyns, and goodness knows what, and suddenly you come out with I Want to Be Free, and sort of like this whole wonderful video.
So no, I think it was just, I was dying to dress up in drag, doesn't everybody, but it was just one of those things. In fact, it wasn't my idea at all. I'm sure everybody thinks it's my idea being outrageous.
It was Rogers, wasn't it?
It was, I mean, it came from Roger, and I was, and everybody thinks, I bet, in fact, they asked me, so how did you get the other three to get into it? In fact, they ran into their frocks quicker than anything. And I said, no, wait a minute, I was still wearing my high heels, and it was just one of those things. It was their idea, basically, and I said, yeah, let's have a go. And in fact, sometimes it's something that would have been so obvious for me to do, but because it was their idea, it was sort of, it came across that much better. I think if it was me that actually started, it would have been very hard for them to accept the role, and I don't think it would have come across.
Right.
So sometimes what is most obvious for me to do, I don't do it because it's harder for the others to do.
Does it please you if you're aware of it, that there are some very staunch Queen followers around the world? I mean, and there's a hell of a lot of them. I mean, it runs into millions that are totally Queen staunch followers. Are you aware of that?
Yes, I know. Yeah, but what do you mean? You're saying that I'm
well, doing something. Well, I mean, I think that in this day and age, and I will use it as an example. I think the Culture Club have had their staunch followers, and they've gone away now to some degree. But with Queen, and there are certain other groups as well that have that same following.
Why do you think that?
There is a very staunch following. Obviously, it's something that must please you, though.
Oh, of course it does, but I mean, I don't know why that happens.
Right. So,
do you know why? I mean, it's just, I think the only way I can put it is, I think after a certain time in the business, and if you're still successful, you do get that following, and I mean, if they sort of grow up with you, they sort of keep up with you, if
right.
you know what I mean, they will sort of accept anything you do. That's what a staunch fan is, as far as I'm concerned. So, I mean, they will believe in everything you do. And in terms of Queen, I mean, we just chop and change so much that... as far as I'm concerned, a staunch fan is somebody that will say, okay, whatever Queen come up with next, I will readily accept, because they're just liable to change so readily.
Right. Well, I mean, on that score, then there are many groups that don't tend to want to tour anymore, and yet you put yourself through what now must be what a 10 month, I mean, tour around the world. Do you like touring?
I like it and I hate it, to be honest. It just depends. I mean, you say it's a 10-month tour. It's not as extensive as the tours that we've done before, because
right.
they were like, literally, I mean, we've had long periods off, you know, in between going, say, from South America to coming here and then going to Japan. I mean, it's not as heavily condensed as it was before, because I like to have the breaks as well, and my voice takes a beating. And so as far as touring is concerned, I think we do far less than you think.
When you say your voice takes a beating, yet you go out on stage and...
Because I sing my arse off, and it's very hard to do it.
That's what I mean. Every night. I mean,
the four shows in Sydney virtually killed me, because it's just... I just had one day off, and I think now I need, you know, more days off. I'd like to do sort of just one show and have a day off, but I mean, that's not applicable to... good touring, because I mean, you've got to sort of
right.
condense them, and I mean, it's all in terms of business and money. But I'd like to sort of, I mean, I could never do a season, as it were, in a theatre or something, you know. I'd burn out, because I'd have to sing a, you know, like Broadway or something. They asked me to do that, and I thought, they're kidding. This is totally off the tangent. So they asked me to do La Boheme with Linda Ronstadt. They thought I could sing
right.
operatically, and. The first thing that came into mind was, I thought, I can't do matinees, and they don't realize that I can't sing for 6 days a week or even 7 days a week, you know, on the same stage, and I get bored to death.
Well, being bored to death, I mean, now you've come out with a solo album, and it puts you under more pressure, because, I mean, one, well, I suppose, has to promote that as well.
Yeah, I'm talking to you. That's about all I'm going to do, to
right.
be honest.
But
that's my worldwide promotion.
But why, I mean, why?
Why?
Yeah.
Because I want to do it. There's something in my system, and it was something that I wanted to do. You know, I think every artist, if he's in a group, wants to do a solo project sometime
right.
or other. And it's getting quite late for me. I mean, after 13 years, I think, I mean, most people thought I was going to do it in the first 5 years and break up the band and things like that. And... I think I'm the third member of the group to actually embark on
right.
a solo project anyway. Roger's done two, and Brian's done a mini project.
Right.
So it wasn't something that... it was there, but I wanted to get it out of my system. But I needed time, and I wanted to do it at the right time. And this happens to be the right time, and I needed a lot of time to myself to do it. I knew I had Queen commitments as well.
Right, so, now, you did the film clip with David Mallard, who is sort of almost one of Bruce Gower's sort of... Yeah, sure. That's right, take my time. Tell me when you're going.
We're rolling and set.
Go. Right, when all seems as if it could be put on video, and you have the likes of the Mr. Mallets and the Russell Mulcahy's and the Bruce Gars and the Brian Grants all collectively together, and suddenly I Was Born to Love You comes out. And
well,
there's more, obviously, to be done with video. And was it your idea about this concept, or was it?
Well, whose else could it be?
Yes, exactly.
It's just a simple love song, and that's the way to do it. It's just
it's not exactly a simple film, Christa.
Exactly. I mean, basically, I mean, in terms of video now, I like to have fun in them, because I think if you do that, it comes across, and then, you know, people can relate to that. And basically, it's just me having fun. So I can't, you know, I can't just sit in a chair and knit a blouse or whatever. I mean, it's just I've got to go through all these horrible sort of scenes and things, which is what I'm all about. So you know, they're just in a funny way, they're just parts of my life, so I'm just putting them in pictures.
Well, exactly, because I mean the first part with that shimmering and that whole idea and the image is changing at the back, and then you think, well, that's just reflection, then you realize it's not. Freddie Mercury.
Yeah, well, a lot of it is on the set. Believe it or not, that particular scene you're talking about actually just happened on the set. We just had an idea of me singing in front of all these mirrored images, so they were going to be static, but they happened to be, they were just plastic sort of coatings. So, I mean, I suddenly decided, why don't we have people stand behind them and just shake them a little and see what kind of effect you get. So it was basically a very cheap sort of way of getting that effect. It's not a big sort of, you know, budget sort of job. And sometimes some of those, you know, things happen at the right time, and they happen to be the best things. So this wasn't actually thought out on paper or anything. We just wanted static images of me, and suddenly all that shimmering happened at the back, and it worked.
Then the girl comes into the scene, and there's this sort of ballet-like sequence where, in fact, I believe now that MTV have in fact...
Well, it's not a ballet sequence. It's like a pas dancing or whatever. It's like the Paris. And it's very, very... it can be very sort of heavy, and some of the outtakes, I think, were even heavier than you see. And basically, I mean, even I couldn't put myself through what she wanted to go through. I had to really slap her hard and all that, because otherwise, I mean, she's a real proper dancer in that field, and I was just going through the motions, and she said she can't perform. I had to actually hit her and throw her and kick her around so that she could actually come back at me and make it believable, because that's what she's all about. And I said, I can't have this in my video, because no one will show it.
Right.
So we just used little snatches, and already MTV finding it hard to sort of relate.
And then it goes through those wonderful sets, which I believe Bryce, in fact,
designed. He's very good. He's very good at doing those sets. And
but it almost, I mean, I don't know if there are edits, but it seems as if it runs through while you're running through.
That's what
set,
I do.
To set. You know?
That's what I do every night. It's just a romp through my house.
Right.
So that came very easy.
Right. Are you happy with it, obviously?
I'm very happy, actually. Very happy. The only thing is I wasn't around to actually be there to edit the damn thing, because I like to sort of... The end result is very important. And because I had to fly over here, and I was shooting till 6 o'clock in the morning on the last night before flying out here. Kind of things that you do. And I don't know, it's just from my point of view, I mean, I could have done different edits, but I mean, you can just, you know, anybody can edit it to death, because we all have different views of how it should be. But it's just one of those things that I'd like to sort of go back and re-edit it. So this is going to sort of form a mini film in the end, with lots of other videos from my solo album. But it's not just going to be videos, it's also going to be hopefully bits of acting, and it's going to be an actual mini film with sort of interesting sort of link pieces. So I'm looking forward to that.
All right, well, you put yourself in the forum again, in the foray of critics and that. Already it's proved to be a hit, so they can't do much about that. Just very quickly, what are your views, and you've seen many come and go, of critics, of music critics?
I don't give a damn about them, to be honest. I think it's... I think they can write what they want, but I think what's more important to me is the public, because, I mean, they keep me here, the critics don't keep me, you know, and the critics don't buy my records, so they don't give me the money. And And until the public, when the public stop buying my records, I'll have to think about it. But at the moment, I'm quite happy.
Now, I don't know if you do or you don't, but if you do, I mean, when you see something like, we've covered the sort of like when the punk era happened and the Sex Pistols and their comments and then many other, and then records.
Oh, yes, I mean, but you'll get that. I mean, anybody that's sort of successful for that long, you know, you can't be a goody two-shoes, you know. I mean, you've got to get a little bit of flack to sort of make you better. I mean, I can't bear the fact, I mean, there might be a few musicians who think they're so wonderful. I mean, I think that's terrible. I mean, we all have our ups and downs and we all have our limitations and we all know that there are certain things you can't do. But I mean, I don't want some asshole critic to tell me that. It's just, you know, sometimes you know about it, and I'd rather have a man-to-man talk with a real musician who can tell me that I'm doing certain things wrong.
Well, if you look at, say, someone like Boy George at the moment, who's going through, obviously, a fairly heavy time, what were your thoughts about Boy George when he first broke out with the Cold Club?
I think he's fabulous, absolutely fabulous. And I think, and he really took it to such great heights, and then that's what you have to pay for that now. And he's okay, maybe he's finding it hard, but I think he's gonna come through it. But it was a very, very
well, he's an obviously a good songwriter and a very good
yes,
singer,
and he's got staying power, which is quite a sort of a heavy ingredient that you have to have. It's sort of, you have to, a lot of people burn out because they can't, you know, it's the pressure that you get by being in the public eye like that. And with Boy George, I think the more he gets, the more he sort of thrives on.
Well, someone asked me yesterday, what should Michael Jackson do? Should he lay off from an album? Should he bring out an album now? Or what? If you were...
Very difficult, because, I mean, you're talking about Michael Jackson, that's like a very specialized, I mean, he's like the biggest thing ever, as it were, I mean, in terms of sales and all that. And you're talking about somebody who's got a very different kind of pressure, to be honest, because he's just been singled out as the most and the best and that way. So, as far as that's concerned, it's hard for me to relate even.
Right. And one of your friends, Elton?
Oh, he's a good old cookie, isn't he? What about him?
I love him to death. He's doing an album at the moment. He's had his ups and downs. He's had a very good
career. He's still around. I mean, yeah. It's just... I think longevity is a very important part in people's things. I mean, it's just you have to sort of, after about the first 3 or 4 years, you've got to think in those terms, not just the next time or whatever. You've got to think of how you're actually going to adapt to your role in life within this circle, you know? That becomes your life. This is how you have to live and breathe, and you can't just say, okay, I'm going to give it another album or whatever. You have to just think in terms of actually living out your life in music, and that's the way I think about it.
Well, I tell you what, you're looking fitter than ever, so I think I might sort of, like, take up music and sort of prance around the stage for a while.
Not bad for a musical prostitute, is it?
Thanks a lot. Okay, let the train go first.